English class, but then ended up ill on the day of baptism for pastor's class. She comes today to receive baptism, so we celebrate that. So on this Christmas season, let us lift our worship and our praise to God. Developed in the 14th century, the word dwell became known as lingering or abiding. It had connections to inhabit, another word developed about that same time. After an Advent and Christmas season focusing on housing the holy, how will we linger and abide in this habit of hospitality? What habits did you invite into your heart during this season that you would like to take with you into the new year? How might we sustain dwelling places that feed, house, clothe those who need it most? We lit the Christ candle or lantern once again that illumines the door of welcome. May this light shine in our hearts, in our lives, and in our church. May Christ's light awaken us to possibilities and lead us to greater hospitality. There is room in this inn, a house for the holy. Peace of Christ be with you. As we rise in body or spirit for our opening hymn, I invite you to pass a wave of hello to the folks on the other side of the sanctuary from you. Stand up to do this. We like to, as you are able, to wave to the folks on this side and the folks on that side. And then turn around to the cameras and wave to the folks at home. Let them know we're glad they're part of our worshiping community. And we're going to sing the first verse of Go Tell It on the Mountain, hymn number 167. Mm-hmm. And I would invite our children to join me. Now, James and Alex, I know you are thrilled. Have a seat. And I'm going to try to sit down, but if my microphone stops working, I got to stand up. We had to move the microphone a little lower to put the plexiglass up, and evidently that, they've concluded that is my issue. But how is everybody? Did you have a nice Christmas? You know what? Some of the folks I think who are with us don't know what we've been doing all Advent. And I know on Christmas Eve, you were telling me that maybe you were tired of our box. Yeah, that's what they told me. They were tired of the box. You like the box? Well, let's tell the folks that might not know what's been happening with our box. See, the very first week of Advent, it was all wrapped up like a nice present with a big bow on. And what did we get to do? We got to open the box, right? And what was in it? Hope. Yes, it was filled with hope, which means it was filled with possibilities. And so we have been using our imaginations during this season to do something with this box. The second week, the Sunday of Peace, what did we do with our box? It became a table of peace that had room for everybody. And then the third week of Advent, the week of joy, what did our box become? A drum of joy. And then last week, we made a cradle for the baby, Jesus, didn't we? And then on Christmas Eve, we made a stable. And today is our last day with the box. Yeah, I can tell that grief. So we got to figure out, okay, what are we going to do with this box today? Because, and we also, did you notice there's this whole stack of toys? We have been inviting you to bring in gently used toys that might be a blessing to someone else. And so we have this whole stack. And somehow I have to take these to the Salvation Army this week. Now how? We could put them inside the box. What a great idea. Let's see if we can make it work. Might need to, yeah, there you go. So you did a good job of bringing in toys, didn't you? See, just when you thought we didn't have anything else to do with the box, all right. Thank you. Thank you for putting them in the box. And thank you for bringing in the gently used toys. How about we say a prayer? Dear God, thank you for these gracious givers who have given their toys that others might enjoy them. And we ask you to bless the children who will receive these toys. Bless them and those who care for them. May they find joy in these gifts. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you for sharing with me today. Excuse me. Now, some of you were not here on Christmas Eve, right? Some of you were and some of you weren't. And if you weren't here on Christmas Eve, I gave the kids ornaments. So I want to give you one for your Christmas tree. And even though you may, it's still Christmas season, so you can still add it to your Christmas tree, okay? Isabel, do you got one? All right. Thank you for sharing today. If you are going to worship and wonder, I invite you to head out. If you're going to stay here, there's creative worship bags for you. You going out, Logan? All right.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his host. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. He established them forever and ever. He fixed their bounds, which cannot be passed. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his faithful, for the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord. This is the word of life.
Hallelujah.
Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we thank you that in every age you have made water a sign of your presence. In the beginning, your spirit brooded over the waters and they became the source of all creation. You led your people Israel through the waters of the Red Sea to their new land of freedom and hope. In the waters of the Jordan, your son was baptized by John and anointed with your spirit for his ministry of reconciliation. May this same spirit bless the water we use today, that it may be a fountain of deliverance and new creation. Wash away the sins of those who enter it. Embrace them in the arms of your church. Pour out your spirit on them that they may be agents of reconciling love. Make them one with Christ, buried and raised in the power of his resurrection, in whose name we pray. Amen. And Brooke comes today first. Brooke, I want to ask you, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and do you accept him as your personal Lord and Savior? God bless you on the decision you have made today. Brooke Ellen Bate, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And all God's people said, Amen.
Complete what I've begun. When the Reverend Hunt, could you join us, please? On behalf of the congregation, we want to thank you for, what was it, the last couple years you've been serving as our pastoral associate. We know that you're going to continue on as our regional elder, and we would like to give you this gift.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I was hurrying. I thought you might be a little wordier, John. As we enter into our time of prayer, we certainly do keep Brooke and her family in prayer on this special day in their lives. We are continuing with our communion, or our prayer response that we have used during this season of Make of My Heart a Stable. And as we enter into our time of prayer, I invite you to join in that as we have been doing. I would like you to lift up today. I'm happy to say that Randy Roberts was able to go home last Monday, and as of right now, as far as I know, we have no one in the hospital, so we rejoice in that. We do lift up all of those who are ill, who are grieving. We continue to lift up those who are displaced because of storms or whatever, for whatever reason, just have no place to call home right now. And we continue to lift up this congregation. Exciting times of transition, but we certainly do pray for the ministry that we might continue to be a place that houses the Holy. Randy, I just saw you there. We are glad you're here and hope you're feeling well. Are there other joys or concerns we should share? Philip? We certainly thank God for the ministry that Desmond Tutu has been for not only the nations of Africa, but for our world. Cindy? Oh, we lift up Matthew Sprankle, who is, last I heard, he was doing very well. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Gracious and loving God, as we prepare to begin a new year, help us to discern what it is that moves us. Open our eyes to see the needs of our community. Open our ears to hear your call. Open our hearts to be filled by the Holy Spirit.
Make of my life a stable, a house for the
Grant us the courage to use the gifts and talents you have blessed us with to do the work you have called us to do. Build this community of faith, strengthening our bonds with one another and with you. Help us to support and encourage one another in our ministry. May all that we do praise you and be to your glory.
Make of our church a stable, a house for the holy, a warm and sturdy place for love to live and grow.
We pray today for all those who are struggling, those who are suffering illness or injury or grief. May healing abound. God of compassion, be born in us. Reside within us. Move outward from us to meet the needs of the world, making a house for the holy that is each and every one of your children. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And we are grateful for those who make our worship possible in as inspiring of way possible. We do thank our musicians. They're down a guitar player today. And yet you still sound great. So we thank all of our musicians for their hard work on our behalf. And Greg and his family are celebrating Christmas together today. And so we are grateful that Justin Allen is back there at the controls and making this happen. Justin's home on break from Kent State University, and we rejoice in that. And back at slides is Callie Buchanan, home from the University of Cincinnati. What would we do without our college students on these breaks? I'm very grateful for them today, and thank you all. We have been telling stories of innkeeping this season, and last week I gave you that whole list of some of the ways that we have been reaching out to house the holy through our Advent workshops. All the blessing bags we created and distributed, and the gifts to Angel Tree. There, the number of projects that we have done in outreach this Advent season has really been amazing, all things considered. And we still have a couple to go. Our mitten garland, which has hats and socks and gloves you have been contributing to all week, will go to the Salvation Army with our toys. The children have been bringing in gently used toys. Many of them are brand new. And so we are grateful for the generosity of our families and our children that might be able to bless others. There are many, in addition to those tangible things, you have also contributed to our Christmas offering that is intended to help our region sustain its ministry to our children, youth, and adults. And in addition to that, you have been very generous in gifts to Week of Compassion to help with storm relief, especially in Kentucky. And so thank you for all the ways in this Advent and Christmas season that you have worked to house the holy. It is an amazing witness. And we thank God that we are blessed and to be able to share what we have to bless others. Let us pray.
Our Heavenly Father, as we receive all of these gifts that you have showered upon us, we return a portion of that so that your ministry may be furthered and the needs of our congregations and those with outside our congregations be met. We would ask your blessing on these gifts and the givers. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Some of you said you enjoyed a quiet Christmas day yesterday. Some of you maybe had larger family gatherings. Our family got together, I'm happy to say. My dad made it for Christmas to come at least for the afternoon. And Amanda and Michael and the boys were there, Aaron and Ben, and the kids came over. So now our house that seems plenty big enough for Tim and I, when you add some extra people, not to mention four grandkids ages 4 to 8, the place seems a little small all at once and very loud. But I have to say, it was great fun. And the kids kept coming in shifts, and they were, you know, opening gifts, and then new people would arrive. And it was just, they had a great time. And I was trying, I had said to my dad, now we are not going to have a formal sit-down Christmas dinner because you can't do that with four kids. So we would have food, and everybody could have food, but, you know, if the kids weren't going to sit down and eat, that was okay. So when dinner got ready, I said, okay, dinner's ready. And four-year-old Tristan announced to everyone, hey guys, dinner's ready, and promptly ran over to the table, took his place. So of course he got a plate and just sat there. He was going to be determined to eat. The rest of the kids really weren't all that interested in Christmas dinner at that point. They were still, trying out some new gifts, but mostly just enjoying being kids with cousins. And so, but Tristan persevered. So at one point it was Tristan and Tim sitting at the dining room table. And I have to think, Tristan was having great fun with the rest of the kids, but he was enthusiastic about eating, which makes the cook feel good. And I have to think, I hope that on the Sunday after Christmas, we can all be as enthusiastic as a four-year-old at this table to say, hey guys, dinner's ready. And that we can be the first at the table, because at this place, at this table, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate that Christ child, whose birth we just celebrated, grew to be our Savior. And what a difference he has made to our lives even now. And so we gather here to remember how on the night before he died, he took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body broken for you. As often as you eat this bread, remember me. And after supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks and gave it to them and said, this cup is the new covenant. It's poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink it, remember me. Supper's ready. Thanks be to God. Let us pray.
Emmanuel.
our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, the first 14 verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who receive him, who believe in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth, the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The prophet Isaiah speaks of light shining that will penetrate the darkness and bring light to all people. 500 years later, John's gospel speaks of that light shining in the darkness as Jesus, the Word made flesh. Words are powerful. Once a toddler learns language skills, there is no stopping them. I admire people who are skillful with words. My friend Cindy Bowman is one of them. She takes words from history and weaves them and scripture and weaves them into poetry and song. She wrote a song and sang it for the occasion of my ordination 35 years ago. And now she lives on the West Coast, and I have not seen her in years. She sent a Christmas greeting a few years back, and I want to share it again with you. She writes, "The Christmas story can be summarized this way. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The Word became flesh. It took on human form and lived among us full of grace and truth. Jesus is the incarnate Word. He is the Word made flesh, the Word of God, the Word of love, the Word of truth and grace and beauty. He is the one who is the love of God in human form. Jesus is the human form of God's forgiveness. He is the human form of God's mercy. He is the human form of God's justice, of God's truth, of God's love. This is the Christmas story. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. God, so that he could help us, decided to walk among us and live with us as one of us, born of human parents, nurtured at a human breast, working at human tasks until he died a human death. God among us, God made flesh, God for us in Christ Jesus." What is remarkable about the Christmas story is not just that God chose to place all his glory, all his beauty, all his truth in a human form, though that is remarkable enough. It is that he chose such a simple human being in which to take on flesh. God's Word, the Word that was at the beginning of all things and without which nothing was made that was made, could have come upon a royal prince or a princess, and it did not. God's Word made flesh could have taken the form of a philosopher, wise and full of truth, living in some imperial palace. And it did not. No, God's Word, the Word made flesh, was a simple Word, a Word made manifest, a Word made visible in a simple human being, born to a simple peasant woman and cared for by a humble carpenter in a land that time still seems to have forgotten. The Word made flesh. The word of God is found in its fullness in a baby who had to lie in a manger because there was no room for him at the inn. The word made flesh, the word of God, is found in all its fullness in a child who, while obedient to his parents, still argued with his teachers and got lost in the city from his parents. The word made flesh, the word of God, is found in all its fullness in a young man who wandered the countryside, teaching the teachers, healing the sick, eating with sinners, and forgiving those who needed forgiving. Jesus was the word of God in its fullness, and yet consider, it was a word that had no home to call its own. It was a word that was denied and betrayed and finally killed in the hope that it would not be seen or heard again. God's word took on flesh and dwelt among us. It lived among us, first within the body of a simple woman and then in the body of a simple man. And that word was both accepted and rejected, but in rejection and then later in death, it could not be destroyed. This is the Christmas story. And it is a story that continues today because the word of God is an eternal word. It's a lasting word. It's an undefeatable word. Jesus, the word of God, is still among us. He's here as spirit, teaching his followers that which they need to know, comforting his disciples with the comfort they need, and leading them to the truth that they need to know. And what is that truth we need to know? Where is the word for us today? It's in the same place that it was when Jesus walked among us. It's in the acts of love that his followers perform. It's in the mercy that his disciples give to others. It is the truth that they utter, the justice they struggle for, and in the forgiveness that they bestow. God's word is still made flesh today, much in the way that it was made flesh in Jesus. God's word takes on flesh when a woman visits a nursing home at lunchtime to help feed a man who needs some patient, loving assistance. And when a man delivers groceries to the local food bank, God's word becomes flesh in the actions of people like those who prepare meals for those in need, who need that reassuring help in the midst of overwhelming circumstances, or those who make the drive to visit a hospitalized friend who is lonely. And when we open our doors to those who are alone for the holiday celebrations or any other day for that matter, the word of God took on flesh in a unique and tremendous way in Jesus of Nazareth, and it takes on flesh today, wherever the word is believed and done. God's word wears human flesh in those who follow the risen word, those who obey the risen Lord and heed the living God. And as it was in Jesus, where the word was found in a simple man born to simple parents, so the word today is found in flesh in simple acts of love and kindness. The word takes on flesh in those who heal, in those who forgive, in those who seek justice, in those who share, and in those who show mercy. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we end our Advent Christmas worship series with one last Christmas carol, and this one is truly about Christmas Day, good Christian friends rejoice. It's a medieval carol that would have been used for folk dancing rather than for church, because it was a more boisterous praise of the newborn child than was permitted in church at the time. It was written in Latin and German, and the original Latin reveals the heart of this song. In sweet jubilation, now sing and be joyful. The joy of our hearts lies in a manger, and shine like the sun in the lap of his mother, Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. Let us remember that the joy of our hearts lies in the simplest of mangers. May our church be a lap of the mother for those who need it most. Let's stand as you are able and sing the first and third verse of Good Christian Friends Rejoice, 164. Thank you. Congregation to do we have Callie, do we have a welcome after baptism? All right, we're gonna welcome Brooke to our church family. We have a certificate so that you might remember this day, and the congregation would like to welcome you. Brooke has risen from the waters of baptism to newness of life. She has become one with the witness of God from all times and places. Through baptism, God promises her the gift of the Holy Spirit to nurture her all the days of her life. Let us add our blessing and pledge our love as we welcome her into this living community of faith. We rejoice in God's empowering love, freely given to each and all. We welcome you, newly baptized, into the circle of God's love in Christ's church. We praise God for the gifts for ministry that you bring to this community. We promise to pray for you, to seek the depths of faith with you, to support you, and to love you. We covenant with you to love God with all our hearts, mind, soul, and strength, and our neighbors as ourself. So, Brooke, consider yourself welcomed as a baptized Christian into the community of faith. And I'll invite the congregation to greet Brooke. Maybe you can kind of we'll gather out there so they can give you their greetings. And now, may the door, God's door of welcome swing open in your heart and in your life. May Christ's humble first dwelling remind you of the plenty you already know. And may the Spirit lead you into more possibility and hospitality than you can imagine, making room at the inn for all. May it be so for you. May it be so for us. May it be so for this church. Go from here to share the good news that Jesus Christ is born. Amen. Hey, come hang out here with me. Thank you, Alex.